You know, if Pauling and Delbruck hadn't written a paper that replication would be best involved complementarity, and that paper was in 39. So the idea had been there. So the moment you see, yeah, this is, separates the two strands.
What about complementarity of RNA to DNA? When did that? Because you had already written DNA to RNA to protein.
No. I think I tried to take an X-ray. I know I did an RNA X-ray photograph that spring. That was lousy. So I was thinking that way, yeah, because protein synthesis occurred in the cytoplasm. DNA was in the nucleus. How was you? Somebody had to take it out there. So, it was the simplest idea. I wouldn't have, felt. There would be so many ways you could get around it. Maybe there's another form of DNA, you could, But it seemed to me it makes sense to always try and follow the consequence of the most obvious idea, rather than to say, well, there can be 100 different possibilities. If one is, there is no DNA in the cytoplasm. But of course, there is DNA in the cytoplasm and the mitochondria. But we did, But then they're little cells, so the exception would prove,
Can you think of another instance in history where someone would see their place in the universe instantaneously in such a dramatic way?
No. Probably there have been, the benzene structure. Well, somehow somebody, but I... Bohr and the simple electron orbits and so on, and then, agreements with spectroscopy. I don't know the field well enough to know how instantaneous. But the answer had been proposed. And then, we have complementarity. And so it was a novel.
But the knowing how important you are now going to be in history to come so quickly and so...
Of course, I didn't know how, but...
When did you know?
Oh, that moment. Sure. But what... Because just solving the structure of DNA, if nothing else happened afterwards, and seeing how genetic information is stored in a linear fashion, that was a colossal step forward. And, we could sequence DNA and go on to personal genomes. We'd found the structure of the DNA and how it was copied. We didn't know how it functioned. And that was the... And, then we had that by 61 in principle. We had transfer RNA, messenger RNA, ribosomes. I wrote a paper in 64 on the two-side model of protein synthesis. Again, that was a simple mind, but it turned out... to be right, except there are three sites, there's an exit site, but it didn't really change anything. I just saw it, we were just very lucky that the structure hadn't been solved by Wilkins and Franklin or by Pauling. That is, it was turned out it was only a three-horse race, and the first two stumbled. They shouldn't have. Neither should have stumbled, but they stumbled. And part of the reason they stumbled is that only I really thought the problem was important. You know. So it was, I wanted to win more than they do because I somehow thought it was a bigger prize. You know, Rosalind had virtually never heard of DNA until Randall had told her that she should work on it. Morris was trained in physics and was always more interested in preventing nuclear war and working for peace than ever was of interest in DNA, figuring it was a bigger problem. Maybe it is. So, Francis intellectually knew it was important, but emotionally wasn't driven to it until he saw the answer. Because, you know, he saw, you know, getting a three-dimensional structure of proteins is of sufficient intellectual achievement. The main part of that is staying with that was fine. So I was the only person in the world who valued the problem correctly. And you could say, well, why did I? I think it was just flowed from, you know, the sort of reasoning from facts that, you know, in Robert Hutchins' exams. Start with these things. What is the logical, most likely conclusion? If you start with it, you arrive at DNA. The others you can argue your way out of, but it's always harder to argue out of it than to say it's yet.